So we have Scott Wasson here with us today, software product manager, software guru, helping us dig a little deeper into Navi. And I know you're a gamer, Scott. I hope that this is very near and dear to your heart to be able to release Navi because it has such a great focus for gamers.
Oh yeah, no, I love GPUs, right? But I'm also, and this is going to sound corporate because I know we're working with them, but I love Borderlands. I'm the biggest fan of Borderlands. Like, the number of hours on my Steam account is shameful with Borderlands 2.
And you won't tell us.
No, that's a shameful number. I'm not going to say.
We'll find out.
But I love it, and the idea that we're going to work with Gearbox on Borderlands 3 to make it run well on Navi is awesome. And my plan is we're going to work right up to the launch of Navi, and then I will disappear. I'll say goodbye to my family, go into my office with my gaming rig, and I will just play through the whole thing.
You're planning on eating during this time?
It'll be just, you know, what, Cheetos and Mountain Dew,
yeah,
just
an IV drip. Nutrient bag.
Scott's going to live the dream.
Yeah, we got the same idea.
He's going to do it.
Yeah, so we know the team behind Navi has been working really hard on the new architecture for years now, and it's obviously a fundamentally different architecture than what we've seen previously. So can you tell us a little bit about what about the foundation of Navi makes it different and what it actually means to have a new architecture?
One of the things about a new architecture is that the architects have the opportunity to look at the way games are going to use a GPU, how data flows through, how different things get executed, and change the balance in order to better match today's workloads. And so a new architecture can mean more efficiency as programs run, as games run on it, which means more power efficiency, more fluid gaming, you know, all of the things that you want from that standpoint. And so Navi really is new in that way. It has a new microarchitecture in the shader core, and then it's rebalanced throughout. On top of that, it is the 7-nanometer process tech that it's built on, which is pretty much the most advanced stuff in the world. Mm-hmm. So it should be nice and efficient from that standpoint as well.
I know that a big focus for Navi is on image quality and realism. So I want to go straight into the software. So I know you're a software guy. Mm-hmm. It's maybe your greatest love, maybe after Borderlands.
Software.
Your family, I'm presuming. I mean,
yeah, well, family might be a little higher on the list, honestly.
Honest. They might be watching, yeah. So let's be safe here. Yeah. So let's talk about the software release that's coming out in tandem with Navi and the new feature, Radeon Image Sharpening, really hitting home on that image quality realism. So that's a upsampling and sharpening feature. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I know you can take something that's 1080p and just sort of stretch it up to 4K, but that doesn't necessarily make it look any better. So what's the secret sauce in RIS that makes that look so good?
You're right. Basically, there are a number of things in modern games that tend to soften images, mm-hmm. whether it's upsampling or it's temporal anti-aliasing or TAA or other methods, FXAA, things like post-process filters, bloom, what have you. All of these things can soften an image. And so this feature is meant to kind of give you some additional contrast back. Mm-hmm. And when used in combination with TAA and, you know, image scaling or upsampling, then it gives a nice pleasing result that looks a little bit better, I think you'd say. And it's an aesthetic judgment, right? Mm-hmm. But I think it looks a little bit better than just upsampling and TAA alone.
I know you shared some images of kind of Radeon Image Sharpening in action with us, and I was really impressed.
Yeah.
Usually for me, when I look at that kind of thing, it's like those highlights, what's different in this picture kind of thing, but I could really easily tell, like, whoa, the wood looks so much better in this one, and what could a user expect to see when they're implementing this?
So the sharpener is actually what we call contrast aware, so it knows sort of based on the sort of local pixel area, you know, how the image looks, how much contrast there is in it, and then it chooses to sharpen more or less depending on that. Mm-hmm. So in areas where there's less contrast, it will sharpen more and kind of draw out detail. In areas where it's high contrast, like a high contrast edge, then it will sort of back down, and so it doesn't cause artifacts like ringing that you'll see from sharpeners, where you have like a bright line along the edge of something that shouldn't mm-hmm. be there. Mm-hmm. And also, very nicely, it avoids undoing the work that anti-aliasing methods do to sort of feather a gradient along the soft edges of objects.
Gotcha.
And so it gives you sort of the best of both worlds. Things look soft where they should stay soft. You don't have artifacts. Meanwhile, it still draws out that crispness and detail.
So what would be a typical use case for Radeon image sharpening?
Okay, so say you have, like in one of the new Navi cards, and you have a 4K monitor, mm-hmm. and you want to play a new game, but it's just very intensive graphically, and so you really don't want to run at a native 4K resolution. You could set the game to run at a lower resolution like 2560 by 1440. turn on Radeon image sharpening, it have the GPU scale the image up to fit the display, and you'll get that additional contrast back with the image sharpening so that it looks nice. And then the performance overhead on this is very low. So it depends, typically we have to measure it, but you know, maybe less than 1% even, depending on the scenario. And so you could get a very fast and fluid experience as if you're gaming at 2560 by 1440, but you get a sharp image on that 4K display.
That's awesome.
Yeah, very cool.
So Radeon image sharpening is not the only new feature coming out with this software release. Can we talk a little bit about Radeon anti-lag as well?
Definitely, definitely. So anti-lag, everybody knows lag in gaming, right? They know it's bad. And there are lots of sources of lag. But one of the sources of lag is just what happens inside your system in the graphics card. And anti-lag is a technology, a technique that we've been able to implement in software to sort of reduce the amount of delay between when you click the mouse or press a button on the keyboard and when you get a response out of the game.
Okay, so is this something that's really going to benefit people who are playing CSGO at 300 frames per second, or is it going to be better for people in a GPU-limited situation where you're playing like a really visually demanding game?
Right, well, you're right that it is about being GPU-limited. That's sort of the place where we, as you know, GPU maker, can come in and kind of you know make a difference. Mm-hmm. So in GPU-limited scenarios, we can take away about 80% of the frame time.
Okay.
A lot of times games, they buffer up a couple frames, and so we're able to take you know a big chunk of the total latency out in that case. What I'd say about esports type situations is that if you're running on a lower power GPU or APU, or if you turn the image quality up to the point where it's straining the GPU a little bit, or you're just in a worst case scenario where the GPU is momentarily strained, that's when the benefits of anti-lag will be the biggest.
Gotcha.
Right? So you could have the potential to make the image look a little bit nicer and still have the lower lag like you would with everything turned all the way down to where the image looks terrible.
Yeah. Okay, so you mentioned that it pushes the CPU work a little bit more in line with the GPU work, is that right? Does it change the order of events, or does it just make it so that the input call to the CPU is more in line or happens a little bit later so that it lines up with the GPU call?
Right, so when you're building a frame in a game, there's CPU work that has to happen and GPU work that has to happen, and that can happen with some overlap, but can be somewhat kind of independent. And the games tend to buffer up a couple of frames in order to make sure that animation continues to look smooth. What can happen in a GPU-limited case is that you could have all the CPU work done for a couple frames and still have a couple frames of GPU work that you're waiting on, which means that you have additional lag. So what we do with anti-lag is we can actually sort of meter out the CPU work so that we don't get too much queued up, so that we're constantly sampling input instead of having this long wait. Right? And that allows us to basically reduce from 2 frames of latency to like 1.2 frames of latency. So we could take out about 80% of the frame time worth of lag in those GPU limited cases.
Okay, and when you're talking about the CPU work, that sort of is the game, right? Like that's your movement, that's physics, that's everything that you're actually doing and engaging in the game. And then the GPU work is just drawing the work that the CPU did. Is that kind of right?
Right. The CPU tells the GPU, I want you to draw these things, and the GPU then goes off. It has tons of threads. It takes some time sometimes. I mean, not to our perception, but in reality, to finish its work. And so that gets queued up. And so what we want to do is just avoid queuing up too much of that work.
Gotcha. So you're reducing that queue, and you're preventing that one batch of CPU work kind of pouring into multiple frames.
Right.
Gotcha.
Well, how are you able to measure such, you know, minuscule response times?
Right. Well, it is. This is sort of a to the nth degree optimization. We're trying to get to the last bit of it, and it is a tough thing to measure, you know, click to response latency. You can use a high-speed camera and do it, but one of the problems with that is just that you need a lot of samples because this type of thing tends to vary depending on when in the frame being processed you've clicked the button, right? And so there's we kind of come up with a better way. We have a little Arduino-based device. It's very simple, tiny little thing with a little chip. It has a USB interface, and it has a photo sensor on it. And so the Arduino plugs into the PC, and it acts as a keyboard, okay? And it will send a command while you're running a game to the system. And then we have a little overlay software program called OCAT that runs on the computer while the game's running, and it has a little colored square. And that colored square will change color when the keyboard command comes in. And sure. So the photo sensor then on the Arduino will know when the colored square has changed color in response to key command. So you have a sort of click to visual response, like measurement that you can do.
That's really smart.
Yeah, and then we do lots and lots of samples to make sure that it's a good statistically mm-hmm. significant result. And we have a way to measure latency.
Awesome.
Okay, and what cards support the Radeon Anti-Lag feature?
So it works on Navi, obviously, and it works on all the graphics core NICs. GPUs,
oh, okay.
And then Raven Ridge and newer APUs as well.
Okay, so it's not game specific?
Nope.
That's great. Nice. Well, it sounds like these features, and of course there's others as well, are going to be really beneficial for gamers.
Mm-hmm.
I hope that you enjoy them on your Borderlands hiatus you're going on. Mm-hmm. And we just really appreciate you coming on the show.
Certainly, anytime, guys. Thanks okay. for having me.
We'll hold you to that.
All
thanks,
right.
Scott. Coming 7-7, we'll be bringing you episode 10 of The Bring Up.
We're going to be talking all things Radeon 5700 series and Ryzen 3000 series.
Subscribe and get those notifications so you don't miss it.